I mean, the public has a tendency to think that when they're not looking at you, you disappear. You know, they think you're television, and that when they turn it off, it's gone, you know, and it's not.
Coming up, an expanded interview with Linda Ronstadt. Hello from New York. I'm Liz Wickersham. Welcome back, Lee.
Thank you very much. I'm Lee Leonard, and this is Showbiz Today Live for Wednesday, February 24th, 1988. Michael Jackson begins his first solo U.S. tour in Kansas City.
Comedians Belton Burrell, Sid Caesar, and Danny Thomas announced plans for their new special, Side by Side.
We'll talk to Wheel of Fortune's Pat Sajak about going up against Johnny Carson.
And we'll interview Moonstruck director and Oscar nominee Norman Jewison.
At the top of the showbiz headlines, by most accounts, the first United States concert of the Michael Jackson tour was a critical as well as a commercial success. The reclusive pop star performed before 17,000 fans last night in Kansas City. Doug Sudoff was there and files this report.
10 years ago, on this day,
Michael packed a man-filled Kemper Arena with fans and music. More than a concert, the kickoff to Jackson's solo national tour became an event. Fans showed up outside the arena an hour and a half before the doors opened. MTV, the cable TV music network, also showed up. As did probably the biggest boombox in town, courtesy of a radio station. Then just before 7, the doors opened, and in they came. 16,000 Michael-hungry fans. For a few bucks, a souvenir, even a photo with Jackson. Well, sort of.
Then you gotta turn it off so I can get their picture.
Not everyone suffered Michael-mania.
Right here. Here's the reason.
But most did.
I expect him to dance, and that's what I like to come see.
The way he moves and just the way he is, because all of the energy he has.
And this, the first of two Kansas City concerts, appeals to all ages.
Well, I like his concerts and I like his music.
Well, maybe a little older than the typical Michael Jackson. No, I just like him. I like the way he moves. I like the way he sings.
Moving to the arena of the Tube, Milton Berle, Danny Thomas, and Sid Caesar were in New York last night to promote an upcoming TV movie, Side by Side. The project will feature plenty of laughs, but it will also address a serious issue. Lauren Sidney explains.
The new CBS movie, Side by Side, stars three veteran performers who refuse to get old. Were they typecast?
Perhaps, said Milton Berle, Sid Caesar, and Danny Thomas during a press conference at the Friars Club to promote this bittersweet comedy, a comedy which has the possibility of becoming a series.
I don't know if Mr. Caesar or Danny are ready at this time, at the age of our life, to do a series every week.
If you'd cut your price, we could probably do it.
The film explores the plight of three best friends who are forced to retire. Acting aside, these three entertainers cannot conceive of retiring from a business they adore.
Retiring?
Wait. I retired once when I was 35. I thought I had it all. I said, that's enough. That's
I say waiting.
After about that 6 month of chasing a golf ball and sitting on another boat, there are no more weekends.
Waiting for me.
Look forward to a weekend.
Waiting for me to retire is like leaving the porch light on for Jimmy Hoffa. She don't know who the hell Jimmy Hoffa is. Just look, in the, look in the yellow pages under cement.
I can never think of it.
What'd you say, Danny?
I didn't say anything, Milton. I don't have a chance to say anything.
Collectively, these three gentlemen have been in showbiz for 150 years, but they've managed to stay young.
Most important thing, I think, is to have a hobby.
And yours is?
Mine is the hobby that I've done for 75 years, and I'm going to be 80, and that is making people laugh. And when I hear a laugh, it just preps me up. The adrenaline comes in, and I get maybe 20 years old again. But that's my secret.
The secret to how their characters stay young will be revealed March 6th, when Side by Side will air. Lauren Sidney, CNN, New York.
The brass at CBS called a news conference in New York today to officially announce that Pat Sajak will become the newest entry in the late-night talk show sweepstakes. Bill Tosh has the story.
Pat Sajak will spin the Wheel of Fortune and try his luck in the game of late-night television.
Whose life will Wheel of Fortune change tonight?
Pat's life will change in January 1989 when he hosts the not-yet-named CBS talk show. Sajak will go head-to-head with another former game show host, the king of late-night, Johnny Carson. Kim LeMasters, the president of CBS Entertainment, said they are firm about their decision to change the network's late-night format.
We look at this as a long-term commitment, that this is something that we have started with 2 years. If the first 6 months are not brilliant, then the second 6 months will be better. The third and the fourth 6 months will be even better past that.
CBS hopes that Sajak's broad-based appeal will carry over to the show.
I like talking to people. I'm very comfortable on camera. I'm very comfortable with people. I'm interested in them. And it's a form of television I think I do well. I've done it locally. And it's something, as corny as it sounds, that I have wanted to do all my life. And it's a great opportunity.
Sajak's contract with the daytime version of Wheel of Fortune ends in December, but he will continue to host the nighttime version for several more years. Vanna White is not slotted to be his sidekick on the new show. Pat, perhaps you can have your cake and eat it, too.
And you're darn good, too.
Bill Tush, CNN, New York.
When Showbiz continues, Linda Ronstadt goes on tour with a mariachi band.
Tomorrow, we'll take a look at the new TV sitcom Day by Day.
Later this week, Harrison Ford talks about his role in the new movie Frantic.
We'll have more Showbiz news when we return.
And now back to Showbiz Today on CNN.
A musical superstar with a wide range in our Showbiz profile, Linda Ronstadt has reached the pinnacle of success singing many forms of music. She hit the top with rock, succeeded singing old standards, hit the Broadway stage in The Pirates of Penzance, and she had a top 10 duet not long ago with the theme from the movie An American Tale. Now Ronstadt is tackling yet another style of music as she sings songs from her own Mexican heritage. She talked with Sandy Kenyon.
Somewhere out there, beneath the purple night.
Linda Ronstadt is no stranger to the top of the pop charts, but here she is simply a daughter singing the songs of her father.
I'm doing it for myself. It's very personal reasons that I'm doing it. And I'm enjoying myself doing it. And if other people learn to enjoy it and discover something that they didn't know was there, that's wonderful.
Ronstadt discovered this music and a lot of other styles in her childhood.
When I was a little girl growing up, we had a very musical household, and my father, being Mexican, sang in Spanish almost exclusively. Grandma loved opera. So, I mean, you could go over to her house any old day and hear Puccini on the turntable. It was always there. My mother had Gilbert and Sullivan in a big book on the piano, and she loved those songs, and she used to sing them, you know. My father sang Mexican music. My sister got real into Hank Williams at some point when I was a little kid. So, all of us liked standard songs.
For more than a decade, most people thought of Linda Ronstadt as a rock and roll singer. It was only when she got closer to her musical roots with veteran arranger Nelson Riddle that Linda Ronstadt began showing her public all she was capable of.
I've got a crush on Sweetie Pie.
With the Nelson material, I didn't have any ambitions for it other than to learn how to do it and to accomplish it as a record. That was hard enough, you know. And I hoped, I had modest ambitions for it. I really hoped that it would recoup its cost so that the record company wouldn't feel I was being totally self-indulgent, and so that I could make another one, you know, because if it pays for itself, then they give you the next budget.
What's new?
Not at all, said the public. which promptly bought millions of what was old.
See, people keep saying to me, gee, this is such a departure for you. Well, it's not. It's just what I've always done. In fact, rock and roll was more of a departure for me stylistically than any of the other things that I've done that seem to be a departure, that seem to surprise people.
What may surprise her fans is the singer's hesitation to perform in front of an audience.
If I were going to choose something to do, it would not be to stand up in front of a lot of people and do something. But I love to sing. I love to sing. I love music. So at some point, you do whatever you have to do music. When you actually take it on stage, you learn a great deal. The audience gives you a lot of information back. So it's useful to grow. You know, if you want to grow, you have to do it.
Ronstadt says she hits the road whenever a new album comes out. But just what form that LP will take is equal part planning and pure happenstance.
You think about doing things, you think about doing things, you think about doing them, and then at some point you just have to do them, you know? I mean, if you don't do them, they don't get done. So, I mean, I can only make so many records a year. And, I mean, I was doing Pirates, I was working there, and I was, you know. I mean, you go from one project to the next, and when the people are around you that can help you do that, then you do that. You know, you have to get the support to do it, and I needed the musicians to help me.
What helps is the star's wide vocal range that's even allowed her, on occasion, to sing light opera.
I've always had that register. I always had that upper register. I just didn't use it in public. I mean, the public has a tendency to think that when they're not looking at you, you disappear. You know, they think you're television, and that when they turn it off, it's gone, you know, and it's not. See, I sing a lot of different kinds of music. I'm just always not standing on the stage when I'm doing it. So, and I listen to a lot of different kind of music. You know, my favorite music really to listen to is classical music or Irish music or Mexican music. I mean, I just don't do that in public. People say, what do you mean you're into that? I mean, I think they think I sit around and listen to my own records all the time, which I never do.
With determination has come the extreme discipline necessary to master a variety of music, each form with its own distinct rhythms and melodies. But the seeds of it all were planted in the songs of her family. Sadie Kenyon, CNN, Hollywood.
Staying with music, Supertramp, the supergroup of the 70s, has sold more than 35 million records in its time. Now the group is re-emerging with a new album called Free as a Bird. Cheryl Washington has the story.
And then they show me a world where I could be so dependable. Oh, clinical, oh, intellectual, cynical.
It was a Dutch millionaire that persuaded Rick Davies, the leader of the super successful Supertramp, to start the band in 1970. And as Davies and saxophonist John Helliwell tell us, the name has specific roots.
Well, it was this an old guitarist who had read a lot. He was an English literature major, or whatever you call it.
Yes.
And, it's the title of a book, The Autobiography of a Supertramp, written by a Welsh poet who came and bummed around the States. I wouldn't recommend it. It's quite boring.
But boring is not the word to describe this group, who has garnered either gold or platinum status for every album they've released. Hopes are just as high for their 10th album, Free as a Bird, heavily flavored with jazz and R&B.
I had a kind of a double upbringing because of I liked to play drums when I was very young, and of course that gets you into the jazz end of things. And then I messed around with piano and I got into the rock end, so there's this double thing happening. I'm trying to bring them together in some kind of way.
And while Free as a Bird might be a return to the band's roots, changes have been made to keep up with the times.
We're using some of today's toys, the computers and the, you know, the DX7s, and updating ourselves. We're trying not to get too dehumanized. I think that's the danger these days. Everybody is jumping on the drum machine wagon. I think even George Bush could make a record these days with the assistance of a drum machine.
During this political season, Supertramp has chosen the diplomatic route. Their tour began in South America and will cover Canada, Europe, the United States, and possibly the Soviet Union. Cheryl Washington, CNN, New York.
That's fine. Nike Incorporated spokesperson Kevin Brown denied today that any agreement has been reached between Nike, the shoemaker, and the Beatles about the use of their original recording of the song Revolution in the company's television advertising. Brown also emphasized that the lawsuit filed by the Beatles against Nike and the advertising agency that did the commercial has not yet been settled. The fourth commercial in our Revolution in Motion campaign will break nationally tonight and will run through March the 22nd as originally planned, said Brown. We'll be right back with more Showbiz Today.
Coming up on Showbiz Today, we'll talk with Oscar nominee Norman Jewison.
Tomorrow, 60s rock group Iron Butterfly reunites to try their luck in the 80s.
And later this week, the legendary Dizzy Gillespie tells us about his PBS special.
Stay tuned for the latest entertainment news.
The director of Moonstruck, a film recently nominated for Best Picture and Best Director Oscars, is enjoying a preliminary victory today. Norman Jewison picked up a Best Director award at the 38th Annual Berlin Film Festival last night. Dennis Michael recently talked with the filmmaker and files this report.
After two hard-edged dramas, Norman Jewison decided it was time for a change.
After Soldier Story and Agnes of God, I was in the mood, frankly, to do a lighter piece. And this particular romantic comedy came along with great potential. The moon, the full moon, hanging over Manhattan, affecting all their lives. And the possibility of weaving Puccini and Laboheme throughout the film made it, for me, like an Italian street opera almost. And I was really in the mood for it.
Moonstruck, written by New York playwright John Patrick Shanley, is a whimsical tale of a widow, played by Cher, who becomes engaged to one man and falls in love with his younger brother. In working with the script and rehearsing Moonstruck's actors, a clear structure for the film became apparent to the director.
I told them that they're all arias that these actors are singing. And Cher's the soprano, and Nicolas Cage is the tenor, and Danny Aiello is the baritone, and the father is the bass, and the mother is the contralto, and then they all get together around the kitchen table, and in the last two reels of the film, and they all sing this fugue together, and it builds in an ensemble to a crescendo and a triumphant ending.
The engagement is off.
In time, you will see that this is the best thing.
In time, you'll drop dead, and I'll come to your funeral in a red dress.
It's really exciting for the filmmaker when you capture the imagination of the audience. And it's great to have a hit.
Dennis Michael, CNN, Hollywood.
Joni Carter is at the Olympics this week, and although she won't be winning any medals, she does have an impressive record. It takes her only 3 minutes to paint a picture. Sherry Sylvester has the story.
Artist Joni Carter is in Calgary painting her impressions of the Winter Olympics. She doesn't carry brushes and palettes like most artists, but rather 900 pounds of computer equipment.
This board just slots inside a PC and it turns it into a 16 million color painting system. And then I have a TBC and an encoder and a decoder and a tape deck and amplifiers and a video in camera and just a few things. And my suitcase.
It's probably a lot easier to understand what she does than how she does it. And these are the images captured by Carter and her computer.
Your heart sings and you say, oh, if I could only create that in a painting, and that's what it is. It's, you never know what it's going to be, you really don't.
She started painting the traditional way, but found the computer age not only gave her a whole new perspective, but an entree into live sports coverage. Carter's covered the baseball playoffs, the Kentucky Derby, several Super Bowls, and the Olympics, which she says are the most exciting and the most exhausting.
In 84, I worked 19 hours a day for 17 days, so when it was over, they literally carried me out in a slab. I said, I won my gold medal, I really did.
Carter has been painting only about half a dozen years.
Did you ever dream when you first started doing this that it would balloon into what you're doing now?
Oh, yes, I did.
You did?
Yes, from the very first time I painted, I was extremely successful. I just picked up paints one day and painted some pictures of skiers and sold them the next day, and I said, this is it.
Carter's next project will take her across the country on a souped-up bus, complete with computer paint kit to capture her images of America. Sherry Sylvester, CNN, Hollywood. And now back to Showbiz Today on CNN.
Okay, folks, get ready. If you live in one of 25 selected cities, the MTV Museum of Unnatural History is coming. It's MTV's four-part, three-dimensional look at fashion, new music, technology, and rock and roll history. Admission will be free when the museum sets up at shopping malls around the country. Not surprisingly, many of the exhibits will feature products made by, you guessed, MTV sponsors. Liz?
What did Jane Seymour, Mary Fran, Anita Baker, and Gladys Knight have in common? A Hollywood dress designer by the name of Margie Kent, whose gowns have been part of the glamour that is Hollywood for more than 10 years. Gloria Hillard has more.
This is Margie Kent behind the scenes.
Okay, let's just cut the front.
Actually, Kent doesn't appear on stage or screen, but her dresses do, from award shows to music videos. On this day, Florence Henderson is doing some shopping.
You know, I'm little. So I can't. You don't want too much. You don't
want
to be overpowered.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
Sometimes they just need something for that performance. You give them something new and special that fits, that makes them feel great. They are phenomenal.
If I don't feel comfortable in what I'm wearing, it affects my performance. I want to know that I'm putting on a dress that doesn't wear me. You know what I mean? That I'm comfortable in, that I look sensational, and I can forget it.
Growing Pains' Joanna Kearns came to the dress designer for a look that would change her image.
People tend to see me as, let me see, I'm kind of the June Cleaver of the 80s with Maggie Seaver on the air. It's a very conventional, straight, upwardly mobile middle American look.
Sometimes they want to be the funny. Sometimes they want to be remembered. You know, sometimes they just say, I have to wear vibrant blue and I don't care what it is.
That's the color Kearns chose for her dress.
Thank you. It's just amazing. I don't feel like June right now. Isn't it wonderful?
Actually, lots of people in the public eye come to Margie Kent for advice.
Okay, Margie, this is your biggest challenge. I need to change my image.
I was going to say that.
No. Yeah,
okay.
You're right. Okay.
Ken promised me she'd work on my new image. In the meantime, she'll be pretty busy. Hollywood's big night out is less than 2 months away, and what do this year's nominees have to say? Probably, I don't have a thing to wear. Gloria Hillard, CNN, Hollywood.
And that's it for this edition of Showbiz Today. I'm Liz Wickersham.
And I'm Lee Leonard. Hit it, Michael.
Point your finger, not in the world. This is my planet. You're one of us.
Just ahead on CNN, take a closer look at Pat Robertson's eye-opening statements on the campaign trail. Next, on Inside Politics 88.